Hello and welcome. Today I will be walking you through how to make use of the Real Orbits mod for space engineers. To start, we will be creating a new, empty world then adding the mod. We will also lower the asteroid density by one level to make collisions less likely. This isn't strictly necessary, but it will make your orbiting marginally less terrifying. And with that done, let's generate the world. Now we need a planet. Spawn one in with the admin menu. Notice that the gravity is felt by the character even this far away due to the reduced gravitational falloff. Now we need a ship to send into orbit. As we begin to accelerate, you'll notice some additional information is now being drawn to the screen. You may also notice some yellow lines that are now being drawn in the world. And we've hit a snag. With only the vanilla speed limit to work with, there's no way we can go into orbit. Let's fix that. Go into the save folder for the world we just created and look for the storage folder. If it doesn't generate for whatever reason, just load back in one more time to force it to appear. There it is. Storage, Real Orbits, config XML. Open it up. Let's change that max speed multiplier to 10. Save the file and let's load back in. By default, the speed limit is not modified so that players can use their preferred speed mod if they are so inclined, but you'll need a max speed of at least 700 meters per second to orbit most larger planets. Now that we have a more reasonable speed limit, let's get up to speed. You'll notice that the info readout now indicates that we are in a stable orbit. If we were to leave this ship and fly off elsewhere, this ship would continue along this path, taking almost 32 minutes to circle back to its current position. By default, we can see the apoapsis, that is, the highest point in the current orbit, marked with a GPS. On the opposite side, we have the periapsis, which is the lowest point. These GPS markers will appear for any grid the local player is currently piloting, unless the option is turned off in the config file. We'll try to circularize a lower orbit, so let's skip ahead about 7 minutes. Now that we're nearing the periapsis, we can accelerate forward, backward, down, and up relative to the direction of motion to try to reduce the eccentricity of the orbit. Or for you Kerbal players, prograde, retrograde, normal, and antinormal. The value E that you see on the info display is the eccentricity. A value of 0 represents a perfectly circular orbit. Values up to 1 are increasingly elliptical orbits. A value equal to 1 is a parabola, and values greater than 1 are hyperbole. Now that we've dropped the eccentricity close to 0, you'll notice that the apoapsis and periapsis GPSs and countdowns have disappeared. This is because their positions are no longer stable enough to stay consistent given how close to a perfect circle our orbit now is. That is, indeed, a circle. The other elements in the displayed info will tell us more about the current state of your orbit. The apoapsis and periapsis elements will tell us the height of each, as well as an estimate of how long it will take to reach each point. You'll also see the total orbital period, the time the entire orbit takes to circle once, listed as T at the bottom right. Eccentricity we've already covered. Inclination as shown as IM represents the angle between the orbital plane and the planet's equator. A value of 0 means an equatorial orbit. A value of 90 means a polar orbit. The final element is the orbital state. It will tell us what the future of our current orbit is. When the orbit will remain stable, it will read stable orbit. When the orbit will result and the grid escaping the planet, it will read escape trajectory. In real life, the cutoff for this would be any eccentricity value greater than or equal to 1. However, planetary gravity and space engineers cuts off at 0.05g. So you will see the state change whenever the apoapsis rises high enough to exit the gravity well. If the orbit dips too close to the planet, it will read unstable slash decaying orbit. This does not necessarily mean that the grid is guaranteed to crash into the surface, but it is dipping below the highest point the voxel map can reach. This means that we may end up hitting a mountain. But more than that, gravity does not fall off inverse square with distance while we're that low, so the orbit will be unstable in any case. If the grid is currently being influenced by more than one gravity field, it will read multiple gravity fields. No stable orbit is possible while in this state. If you are seeing this a lot, you may want to space your planets and moons out a bit more. In the vanilla star system world, the Earth likes gravity well completely encompasses its moon, which makes orbiting the moon impossible. For this reason, it is highly recommended that you build your own star system with planets and moons spaced out as you please to account for the larger gravity wells. Now that we've covered the basics, let's cross over to examine some of the other options in the config file. The character gravity multiplier changes how much harder planetary gravity pulls on player characters versus other entities. In vanilla, the character experiences twice as much gravity as grids do, which allows a player to walk around on a grid while it is in free fall. However, if we want to experience proper microgravity while on a grid in orbit, we can set this value to 1. Next we have a toggle for the gravity fall-off override applied to newly created planets. Turning this off will make it so that new planets created while this mod is enabled will not have their gravity fall-off overridden. This likely won't need to be used and is included purely for completeness's sake. The next two values concern orbital info and paths being displayed for player characters themselves. By default, these values are off, but if we want to see orbital data for your player character, we can turn one or both of these on. Following that, we have the toggles for orbital data for grids themselves. If we want to see only the text info or the paths, we can toggle each as you like. The next is the toggle for the visibility of orbits of enemy grids. By default, grids and orbit belonging to someone hostile to you will not have their orbit or GPS be visible. This is the prevent abuse on PvP servers. However, we may prefer to have all orbits visible for PvE worlds. Next up is the maximum draw distance for orbits and GPSs. If the player is further from the center of a planet than this distance, orbit paths and GPSs will not be shown. The default cutoff is 500 kilometers, which is reasonable for vanilla planets. However, if you are using supersized planets, you will likely need to raise this for orbits to be visible. The next values toggle whether the grid GPSs and the apoapsis and periapsis GPSs will appear. Following that, we have modifiers for the appearance of the orbital paths. The thickness modifier will change the thickness of the lines drawn in world. The render divisions modifier will change how many line segments will be drawn to outline each orbit. If you are having performance issues with this mod, lowering this value will likely alleviate the problem. The next value allows us to control where on the screen the orbital info is drawn. The default position is reasonable when using the vanilla HUD, but for anyone using a custom HUD, this will allow you to move the info somewhere else on the screen. The next few values allow us to change the color of the orbital paths. The paths will be drawn as different colors depending on whether the grid is currently being piloted by the local player and whether they are friendly, neutral, or hostile to the local player. These colors will also apply to the GPS markers on the grids themselves. There is also a value to set the color of the apoapsis and periapsis GPS markers. While in game, we also have the option to toggle both the orbit data and the orbit paths display. Ctrl-O will toggle the display of the orbital info. Shift-O will toggle the display of the orbital paths. We can also switch between a normal and full display of the orbits. The normal display will cut outline segments from orbits that get too close to the player to avoid having to see giant lines drawn too close to the camera. The full display will not filter those segments out. For those who want to add this mod to an existing file rather than build a new solar system from the ground up, there is a way to achieve this. Go to the same save folder for the world that the storage folder we found before lives in and look for this file. Open it up and search for references to gravity falloff. Change all of the values to 2 and save the file. Then you will need to delete the SBSB5 file in the same folder to force it to regenerate with your changes. It's recommended that you back up both files before making any changes as any mistakes may break the save file. Then load back into the game. It will give you a warning. Click through it. Now the save file's planets have been modified to have the correct falloff to support orbits. If you decide to disable the mod on that file, you can simply repeat the process but change the falloff values back to 7. That covers most of the basics. This mod currently supports single player, multiplayer, and dedicated servers. And now, if you'll excuse me, I have to go rescue Jebediah again.